This is the fourth part of the series on gait analysis, where I will discuss some basic musculoskeletal biomechanics. This will be fairly brief and very basic. But I have to start with a bit of a discussion of the gait cycle, which we'll go into in much more detail in the next segment. And the gait cycle is how we look at gait in a systematic way. And that each cycle is like the one that preceded it and follows it. We walk with the same motions at every stride. And the gait cycle always begins with foot strike, where the foot hits the ground. Usually in normal gait, this will be the heel, but in pathologic situations, it might be the toe or the entire foot. But in any case, foot strike begins the gait cycle, and as you progress forward on the planted limb, that is stance phase, and when the foot lifts up off the ground, that's known as toe off, and that's the differentiation between stance phase and swing phase, where the limb swings forward to position itself to accept weight for the next step. So that's the gait cycle. We have these rigid bony segments, the pelvis, femur, tibia, and as well the foot, which are connected by mobile joints, the hip joint, the knee joint, the ankle joint, and to some extent the subtalar joint, because the rest of the foot is fairly rigid on the basis of the strong ligamentous connection between the bones. And this is all controlled by highly coordinated muscle activity, which is both concentric, the green in this animation, and eccentric, the red in this animation, the concentric providing the power, the eccentric providing the control. And this is all orchestrated and controlled by neural mechanisms, both from the cortex, the cerebral cortex, the cerebellum, and as well at the spinal cord level, where there are connections between the two legs that help keep them synchronized. Concentric contractions provide movement and power to the joints. And this means as the muscle is contracting, it shortens. In this example, the biceps brachii contracts, shortens, and as it does so, it causes the forearm to flex on the upper arm, and this causes this movement, and that's concentric muscle activity. On the other hand, eccentric activity, the muscle is firing, the sarcomeres are in contraction, but they're being stretched out so that the muscle belly is stretched out. And this is eccentric contraction, which prevents the forearm from just crashing down onto the surface here. And in gait, the muscles on one side of a joint may be functioning concentrically to provide power, and the muscles on the other side of that joint may be firing eccentrically to provide control. We're going to talk about each individual joint at this point and what happens at that joint in gait. And here you can see the limb is about to accept weight and begin stance phase, and both the gluteus maximus, which provides 80% of the hip extension power, and the hamstrings, which provide the remainder, are green, so they're about to start contracting concentrically to bring the hip into extension, to bring the center of mass forward. And this is the real power of gait in the normal state. In addition, the pelvis can rotate on the hip. At the beginning of stance phase, the contralateral pelvis is somewhat posterior, and as we progress through stance phase, it becomes more anterior, and this allows for smoother gait pattern and less side-to-side motion of the upper trunk. And finally, at the end of stance, as the hip lifts up the leg off the ground, the leg flexes during swing phase to prepare it to accept weight for the next step. The hip also provides stability in single limb stance in the coronal plane, because when you're standing on one leg, the center of body mass is in the middle of the pelvis, and the axis of rotation of the stance phase leg is at the hip joint, and so there's a tendency for the pelvis to want to droop and rotate downward during single limb stance. And the reason that it doesn't is because you have a strong abductor mechanism between the pelvis and the greater trochanter, which balances that force to keep the pelvis level and to balance the body weight. This is similar to these tower cranes, which you see in many cities nowadays, with the long arm for the lifting purposes and the short arm to balance that longer arm. But you see, the short arm has a lot of weights attached to it to maintain that balance. The knee starts off stance in full extension, although it flexes a little bit after weight acceptance. The knee then goes into full extension so that it provides a stable pillar during stance phase. If the knee does flex during stance, this demands excessive work by the quadriceps. And then the knee flexes during swing so that the leg can move forward smoothly and the foot can clear the surface so that the leg can then be planted and accept weight for the next step. The foot and ankle is a little more complicated. The foot in stance provides an adjustable, stable base of support, and it also acts as a brake to control the forward progress of the body in stance phase. We'll go into this in a little more detail in the subsequent sections, but this is very important, this eccentric activity of the gastroc soleus during stance phase to keep the foot from dorsiflexing excessively. And then at the end of stance, the gastroc soleus switches from being eccentric to being concentric as there's a bit of plantar flexion to launch the leg forward during push-off. In swing, the dorsiflexors work to keep the foot dorsiflexed and allow for foot clearance from the surface. So the structure of the skeleton and this coordinated muscle activity allow us to walk. How do these people walk with rigid knees and lack of feet? They have to use a number of compensations. They must take short steps, walk at a fairly slow velocity, and circumduct the hip to advance the leg. And I think the answer to this question, what do you think? I think it's probably no, because they can't really move their pelvis enough and circumduct enough to ascend or descend steps unless perhaps they're very small steps. So in cerebral palsy, which is a concern for many of you who are watching this, the primary problem is that muscle activity, particularly eccentric activity, is excessive and it's prolonged. And this interferes with this normal orchestration of muscle function, which allows us to walk.